It's my proud privilege today to talk about this wonderful book by Rajiv Malhotra ji, Sanskrit Non-Translatables. People may wonder that why so much fuss about a few words, you see. Since translation is such a universal activity, books are getting translated from one language to another, one culture to another, and why such fuss? Well, because it has a history. You know, to subdue a country, you have to subvert its culture. And to subvert its culture, you have to demean or undermine its knowledge. You have to change the character of its knowledge. Uska swaroop badalne ki avashyakta hai. Because only that way you will make people lose respect for their own thought, their own culture and their own civilization. Now, Hindu civilization is it is the only civilization that has continued to be alive and kicking, continued to live in spite of all the history of disasters, invasions and all that. And so it has continued to live for almost 7,000 years. In fact, more than that, but we say 7,000 because we have the Sonauli excavations, we have the Mehrangarh and so on. To subdue a country, you subvert its culture. And since our civilization is a knowledge-centered civilization from day one. Gyan kendrit sabhyata hai. Gyan kendrit. Aur is gyan kendrit sabhyata se, from this knowledge-centered civilization, we have evolved a value-oriented culture. Ek mulya adharit, Sanskriti. And from this mulya value-centered, value-oriented culture, which is founded in the vast knowledge heritage of our country, we have developed a unity of consciousness in this country. Chaitanya ki ek atamta. People think alike. Wherever you go in this country, they think and they behave and they act alike. They share the shared value. It has all come because of the vast, massive knowledge heritage. Imagine, Hindu civilization is from day one a knowledge-centered civilization. We have the world's first book, Rig Veda. We have the world's first poetry, first prose, first book of mathematics, first book of astronomy, first social sciences, first book of phonetics, first book of etymology, first book of meter, and you go on and on. We invented the numerals. We invented the decimal system. We work out the value of pi. We worked out the movement of the planets. We worked out the distance from the earth to the sun. And all long before the Western civilization or any other civilization had any idea. Now this Macaulay got it right. You want to rule these people, you have to subvert their culture. You have to make them lose their respect for their culture. And how do you do that? You do that by demeaning its knowledge, by altering the character of its knowledge as it is understood by the people, Because in the Hindu civilization, knowledge is central. Knowledge is the root of everything. Gyan Marga is the supreme Marga. And because as Krishna, I was almost saying Lord, but then Malhotraji would have objected because Bhagavan is not Lord. And quite rightly, he's an avatara, a manifestation. And so Krishna tells Arjun, knowledge is a great purifier. There is no purifier like knowledge. Knowledge purifies more than the fire, more than the water, more than the fire. Knowledge is a purifier. It's such a different metaphor from the contemporary metaphor of knowledge is power. Knowledge is purifier. It purifies yourself. And of course, by purifying yourself, it gives you control over your own self. You don't gain knowledge. You don't become knowledgeable. You aap gyan ka arjan isliye nahi karte that you have to rule others, to exercise dominion over them, to exercise as in Deuteronomy Adam is asked to. You don't do that. You control yourself, because yourself is your enemy, yourself is your friend. There is no other outside. There is no other in the Hindu civilization. So this great knowledge tradition, knowledge centered, and knowledge is constituted in language. Knowledge is constituted in language. As our great Bhartrihari, 5th century says, Sa Jnanam Sarvam Shabdena Bhasate. Jnanam Sarvam Shabdena Bhasate. All knowledge is constituted in language. All knowledge is constituted in language and in words. There is no thought, there is no cognition which is not accompanied by words. Not that you cannot eliminate the words in your meditation, which is the yoga philosophy, but in a normal human concourse, the normal human mind functioning, now there is no cognition which is not accompanied by a word. So knowledge is jnanam sarvam shabdena bhasate, and this jagat, this innumerable world that we see around us, this jagat, ye bhasha ka vikalp hai. It is a construct of language. It's a language. You see, language in the Western civilization, from the day Moses went up and asked God to write down his commandments, and God wrote with a hand of fire. Language is representational in the West. It represents a pre-existing reality. But language in India is constructivist. It constructs the reality. It constructs the reality for us. So language, that's why jnana is at the center of our civilization. And since jnana exists in language, language is as important to us as great scholar Fitzgerald said, that language is central to the Indian civilization, just as geometry is central to the Greek civilization. So language is at the center. All knowledge constitutes language. And our massive knowledge heritage, massive, the whole Vedic Vangmaya, you know, you have a Veda, which is a conceived accumulation of ideas. It has Samhitas, which are then composed into various shakhas, schools, and then it has corresponding Brahmanas, it has corresponding Aranyakas, it has corresponding Upanishads, it has corresponding Pratishakhyas, it has corresponding Dharmashastras, and massive Vedic Vangmaya. And that Vedic Vangmaya went through the entire Bhakti movement. It went through to all Indian languages. And Indian languages are permeated by this knowledge, which is the srot. The Gaumukha, the srot, the source of, source is of course the Vedas. But then from the Gaumukha, the river flows, and the river has flowed in several streams. It flows several streams. The streams are the streams of Indian languages, and the knowledge has permeated the Indian mind. So, since that knowledge, our granthas are in Sanskrit language. So, Sanskrit is important. Sanskrit is important, very important, because all our knowledge is constituted, most of our knowledge. There are of course, four knowledge resource languages in India. There is Sanskrit, there is Old Tamil, and there is Pali, and there is Prakrit. Pali, Prakrit, and Old Tamil, and Sanskrit. But the massive body of literature, intellectual literature, you know, in Sanskrit and in all these languages. You see, unless the conceptual framework of Indian thought is shared in the intellectual texts of these knowledge resource languages, is shared, as it is shared even in the modern Indian languages, which have inherited not only the vocabulary, most of the tatsam tadva vocabulary, but also the syntax and the semantics to a large extent from the mother language, the source languages. So this whole knowledge existing in Sanskrit, so Sanskrit is important. In 1994, Justice Kuldeep Singh ji, he delivered a judgment on Sanskrit, you see, and that judgment is a historic judgment. And I remember him with great reverence and great respect, because Justice Kuldeep Singh ji took 6 months, gave a date for 6 months. He studied Sanskrit, Vedic Vangmay, he studied texts, knowledge texts, shastras, and he began to understand. And then he delivered the judgment. and he made a historic comment. He said, Sanskrit is not only a language, it is the vocabulary of our thought and culture. So if we tinker with the vocabulary of our thought and culture, you know, this statement of Justice Kuldeep Singh ji reminds me of in Valmiki Ramayana, Angad telling Ravan, where Ravan says, oh, why are you see, your father Bali was a great fighter and a great man, and you are just becoming a devotee of an ordinary human being, Purusha, Manushya. And Angad got, because in our culture, you don't hear ill spoken of people you respect. You don't hear. If you hear somebody speaking ill, either you protest or you walk away or you walk out. Angad protests. He says, he put his foot down strongly and he said that, क्या गंगा एक नदी है? Is गंगा only a river? Is कदली only a tree? Is राम only a मनुष्य? You see, in the same way, Justice Kuldeep Singh said, is Sanskrit only a language? Because the case was about teaching Sanskrit along with Arabic and Persian. And the government had introduced Arabic and Persian as choices for Sanskrit. And a Sanskrit teacher who had lost his job, he went to the court. The lower court, you know, decided against him. But then he went to the Supreme Court. And luckily for India, a Sikh judge took the responsibility. When the other judge refused, I won't name these, the other judge did not take the case, the senior most judge. He gave it to Kuldeep Singh ji. I'm so glad it was given to a Sikh, because a Sikh is not afraid. A Sikh is not a gambler. A Sikh does not look for benefits or profits for the future. So he gave the judgment and he said, Sanskrit is not just a language. It is the vocabulary of your thought and culture. And it is this vocabulary which has created the culture of our people. You see, this country's land is, as Vishnu Puran says, ये योग भूमि है, भारत योग भूमि है, योग की जितनी भूमियाँ, all the earths, lands that are there in this world, in this world, they are all भोग भूमि, they are all lands of indulgence. Only India, Bharatvarsh, is the land of abstinence, land of restraint. We have three values in our life, cultural values: Sanyama, restraint; Niyama, the preferred way of doing something; and Shraddha, reverence for objects, reverence for plants, reverence for people, reverence for everything, even inanimate objects. In India, if a child touches something with his foot, the mother will say, why are you touching it with your foot? Pick it up and put it aside. So these values, the land is yoga land, the civilization is knowledge centered, the culture is value oriented, and this culture has generated a consciousness, chetana, which is shared all over the country, regardless of differences of language, differences of faith, differences of food. You know, wherever you go in this country, whether you are understood your language or not, you will feel you are in the same country, because of the values that are manifest in the conduct of the people. I remember great KPS Gill sahab. KPS Gill was the IG of Punjab who put down militancy, and he was invited to JNU. And JNU, as you know, is an intellectual place. And we were all discussing in those days, is India a nation? Is India a nation? Forgetting everything, forgetting that Namdev, when Gyaneshwar took Jivant Samadhi in Alindi, Namdev from Maharashtra, he went to Ghumman village in Punjab, from Maharashtra to Punjab, and lived his life there. And Namdev's Bani, Namdev's verses, they are first found in Guru Granth Sahib, the 15th century text of Punjab. So, in fact, in those days, people had no doubt that this is a, that they, we didn't have the post-Bismarck European concept of a nation. We were a rashtra, a cultural entity, and our chetana, chaitanya, ki ek atamta. There is a unity of consciousness which has been generated by the massive knowledge tradition which has percolated down to the masses. You talk to an ordinary Indian, ordinary rickshawala, one who drives a rickshaw for his livelihood all through the day. You ask him fundamental questions and he will give you the answers. You will be amazed. You will be amazed. You will wonder from how he... I remember once an ordinary rickshaw driver having tea, telling me that, Babuji, gentlemen, you know, this water, we were talking about the Ganga and all that. This waves, the bubbles, the froth, they are only forms. They are forms which arise in water and they collapse in water. They are all water. In the same way, we are all forms. In this vast Brahmanda, he used the word. Brahmanda. Brahmanda literally means egg-shaped universe. Elliptical universe. In the entire Brahmanda, he says, is a pulsating matter. ये जल की तरह है, ये समुद्र है, और इसमें, in this, forms arise and forms collapse, and they go back. I was so amazed. I say so amazed. And much later, when I was reading Adi Shankaracharya's, one of the commentaries on the Upanishads, I discovered that the idea came from him. The idea has come from him. He has given this example of this, you see, while exploring his concept of Advaita, you know, the Vedanta, he explored this idea, how the differences in form are only constructs, appearances. It is all water ultimately. And now I wondered, how has this gone down? So the knowledge which is enshrined in the text composed in Sanskrit language, that knowledge has gone to the minds of the ordinary people. The UNESCO illiterate is a highly educated, wise Indian. This UNESCO illiterate is a highly educated, wise Indian. And the educated Indians, you know, Anant Kumara Swami, educated in our system of education. He said, he used the term educated Indians, and then he gave a footnote. This is how we describe the victims of Indian education. Educated Indians. The educated Indians won't know this. They don't have this idea. They were perhaps, when they were children, they might have been given this idea by the grandmother. But the overlay of our education, the overlay has made them forget. As I say, the education has disaffiliated us from our own self, from our own culture. So this gentleman, how did it come to him? Through mechanisms of knowledge dissemination. We don't believe that knowledge is only for the elite or knowledge is elitist. You see, the knowledge is transferred, is disseminated, is percolated to the ordinary people by the ancient Katha Pravachan Parampara. Ancient Katha Parvachan Parampara. We have an ancient system of, you know, great minds, you know, explaining texts and ideas to ordinary people in the language of the people. Adi Shankaracharya himself was in fact a parivrajaka, a traveler. He wandered around the country 3 times, and as a sannyasi, after he had done 8 yojanas, he would stop along with his shishyas, disciples. And they don't go into a human settlement, so they generally stay outside. The villagers come, they ask, they bring fruits and all that, because they know the sannyasi eats only once in 24 hours. And swam paki, three handfuls of anaj he eats in 24 hours. And that too self-cooked, and he doesn't eat cooked food. So they bring even today, the villagers in India, when the sadhus and sannyasis are traveling, they feed them in the same way. They give them raw anaj, they give them fruits, and so they go. And then they ask questions, and they asked questions. And Adi Shankara answered the questions. And he traveled for 8 months a year. And during 4 months of rainy season, called Chamasa, he went back to Sringeri, his peat, and then he composed the Granthas in Sanskrit. Just as I often speak now, I often lecture in Hindi, in Punjabi. But when I write an article, I write in English. But of course, I write in other languages also. But mostly people then write in English. The same way, he wrote in Sanskrit. Now, Sanskrit, by that time, had become, you know, had ceased to be a spoken language. It did not die. It lived, began to live in its grandchildren. Just as a grandmother lives in the grandchildren, the Sanskrit language lives in the Indian languages. That's why through the Katha Pravachan Parampara, in the Lok Bhasha, in the language of the people, because no human effort is an end in itself in our culture. Every human effort must be addressed to Lok Sangraha, the word which is used thrice in Bhagavad Gita, welfare of the people. Everything must conduce to the welfare of the people. Knowledge also must be to the welfare of the people. So they did, and from 9th century onwards, 10th century onwards, you see, the knowledge which was enshrined in the text composed in Sanskrit language, it was vernacularized in the languages of the people. Kamban, a great Tamil poet, in 9th century, he translated Valmiki Ramayana into Tamil. And it started a process of 800-900 years. 800 years, the Indian, great Indian minds all over the country, they rendered Sanskrit knowledge, Sanskrit texts into Sanskrit texts into Indian language, into living Indian, into Boli, into Bhasha. The word Bhasha itself means spoken language. Panini never wrote in Ashtadhyayi that I am writing a grammar of Sanskrit. The word does not exist. He said, I am writing a grammar of Bhasha, spoken language, and Chandas, compositional language. So, through Katha Pravachan Parampara, the question arises, how did Adi Shankaracharya, did he know 1500 languages? No. India, you see, these constitutional figures, the census figures are not to be believed. Communication in India is through five prakrits. You see, one prakrit, if you start from the north and you kind of speak kind of a Hindustani, you can come to Delhi, Haryana, Rajasthan, Gujarat, Maharashtra, Madhya Pradesh, UP, Bihar, the whole tract you cover in that prakrit, that mixed language. And from Maharashtra, you go down to Belgaum, and you inflect it as you walk through, inflect it with the local speech, and you have the second prakrit, the Dravid. And then from Andhra, when you go towards Odisha, from Odisha right up to Assam, you have the third prakrit. And then in the northern, northwestern states, like Naga and Manipuri and others, you know, you have this fourth prakrit, Sinotip. And then from the Himalayan mountains right across to Dardic languages, you have the fifth prakrit. Five prakrit. And people communicated. India is a communicative zone. So Indian languages share syntactic, semantic and grammatical features. And the vocabulary. Most in all Indian languages have a sizable portion of their vocabulary is tatsam tatsav tadbhav words of Sanskrit. We will not use the word borrow. It is not a case of borrowing. It's a case of one speech area breaking up into several speech areas. And just as the phonological changes take place, the words of that speech area, they take local forms, you see. So, you know, something small, like something, tesan, somebody, shaiva, some kind of shaiva, kukanda seva, kukanda shev khaunga, sasha, it's a localization. So it has broken up. minimum vocabulary, tatsam tadbhav, from the original sources, is in Tamil about 70%. And the highest percentage is almost up to 90% in Punjabi and Hindi and, you know, Marathi and all that. So the vocabulary is shared and the syntax is shared. We are all verb final languages, Indian. And look at the alphabet. The alphabet, it is a selection from a very powerful alphabet system, the Katyayani Varnamala, the garland of sounds, which was prepared by Katyayana in 3rd-4th century BC. All Indian alphabet is a selection from that Varnamala. So there is a unity. There, India is a single communicative zone, and the unity. And therefore, a sannyasi like Adi Shankaracharya, a guru like Gorakhnath, a guru like Guru Nanak, he could travel all over the country and speak to the people, and speak to the people in the language of the people. This Katha Parvachan Parampara made knowledge in India democratic. It was part of the people, part of the people's minds. And even today, in India, if you come to India and you open the TV channel in the morning, there are 20 channels where you will find great minds, you know, expounding texts. Somebody expounding an Upanishad. Somebody is expounding an epic, a Ramayana or something. And millions of people listen to them. There is no knowledge system more democratic than the oral knowledge system, which is India's orality. India's knowledge tradition is oral. Knowledge is created in the mind, it is stored in the mind, it is disseminated orally, it is dispersed orally, it is sent orally, and preserved orally. And that's why we are the people who invented the science of phonetics. First, science of phonetics from day one. Along with the Rig Veda, we had the Vedanga. So language is important. And the second process was vernacularization. The texts were vernacularized, translated. As I said, Kamban. And then you have Ramanujacharya, you have Gyaneshwar, you have Narsi Mehta, you have Mirabai. After Mirabai, all the bhakti poets of India, when they are singing their bhajans, what are they doing? They are transferring the Vedic knowledge and values in the language of the people. And in a pleasant way, vani, metrically, because when they sing and when you hear a song, you remember it more easily than mere prose. And there's no wonder that our knowledge texts are metrical. Our knowledge texts are metrical. You see, Rig Veda is a collection of the thoughts of the wise people of those days. It's a Sangra Grantha. And it is in Chanda, meter. Guru Granth Sahib, 16th century. Guru Granth Sahib is a collection of the knowledge, thoughts of the wise people of that time in India. It is a Sangra Granth, and it is in ragas. It is in ragas, melodies, music. Because how is it knowledge texts of music? They are easy to remember because you have to put them in the mind, and they are easy to understand, and they have a charm, and people listen with attention. So vernacularization or orality. And that's why a mechanic of mine, a Muslim mechanic, you see, Muslim mechanic, he told me one day, Muslim boy, he said, Babuji, ab is gaadi ko chalta kar do. I had a very old ambassador car. Chalta kar do. I said, why? Kyun? Kyun? Ke Babuji, jiski paid hoti hai, uska khatma hota hai. That which is born has to die. He was speaking Bhagavad Gita. Did he know that? No. He didn't know. How did this idea reach him? This idea reached him because Bhagavad Gita, Krishna says, that which takes birth has to die. And it has reached him through the word of mouth, through great expounders, through people who have addressed small and large gatherings and explained to them ideas in relation to the contemporary times, contextualized. The great ideas are contextualized and made pleasant by these people. Abhinav Gupta says that the drama or poetry, after all, their source is also the same. The source is the jnana from the Vedic Vangamaya is the source of poetry and prose, poetry and drama. But by watching a drama and by listening to a poem, you also get moksha. Moksha, just as by reading. How? Because after all, in a drama play, every time the play is staged, the performers are different, the time is different, it is changeable, it is momentary. And from that changeable and momentary thing, every time a person sings a poem, every time somebody sings a geet in Assam, a harvesting song or a marriage song, it is different. How is it from such a changeable, momentary thing, you get moksha, you get jnana? He said, after all, this world also is only a play. You see, it's changeable, momentary. By meditating on, chintan manan karke, is sansar ke chalayaman aur chalit sansar. This changing, moving world, after looking at that, thinking about it, meditating on it, we gain knowledge in the same way from this. So language is the key. Language is the heart. As Stahl said, that language is central to the Indian mind, just as geometry was central to the Greek mind. And in the Rig Veda, in the 10th book, in the hymn of Dirgh Tamasa, there is a beautiful line, Gauri Mimaye Salilani Takshati. Language cuts forms in the ocean of reality. Language cuts form. The reality is an ocean. It's an ocean. You cannot cut forms. In geometry, you are taught to segment, to measure, to dissect, and then put together. That is the Greek view of terra firma as reality. But for us, terra cognita is the reality, not terra firma. And the forms we construct through language, through words. We name, to name is to know. We name and we know. We name and we know. So language is central. Now Sanskrit language, which is the medium of our intellectual heritage, it is there. Macaulay got it right. You subvert the culture. How do you do that? You change the akar, gyan ka swaroop badal dijiye, change the character of knowledge. How do you do that? You change the language. You change the language, that is one. So he said, we'll not teach them in their languages. And the second method is that you render the text from this language, Sanskrit, into other languages, either in such a way that the concept changes and the concept begins to look either illogical or foolish or repetitive or tautological. These are things are all counted in our tradition.